Florian, welcome to Stoff Talks, and thanks for being here with us today. We will be talking on the open banking side, and you are as a CEO of FinAPI in Germany, as a partner of Maxi Digital, our subsidiary. First of all, I want to thank you for being here, but more than today, you helped us a lot to improve our product and serving to our customers. And thanks for this one as well. And welcome to our Soft Talk series today. And first of all, I want to know your personal story and the story of FinAPI, how it all began. Can you please share your story with us and how FinAPI began and what's your focus areas? Can you explain, please?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. It's actually my pleasure to have a little bit of time with you today and share our story. Well, I started founding FinAPI with my co-founder Martin back in 2008. So it's more than 12 years ago. And back then, we started the company not as an API aggregator, but rather as a personal finance management solution. Personal finance management solution, you see a lot in online bankings. It's where you can analyze your finances, how you spend your money, how much are you spending for supermarket, for dining, etc. And back then, when we implemented this software, we already had the idea that a personal finance management solution must include all bank accounts, not just one bank account, but all my bank accounts. And in Germany, it's quite common to have two, three, or four bank accounts. So we had this back then, it was a side function to include in our PFM solution a multi-banking functionality where you can upload all your banking data in one place. This was basically our idea.
But I think there were no APIs or something
No,
on
no,
these
no,
days.
there was
No.
no
It's
APIs. We did a
really
lot about,
visionary.
yeah, we did a lot about connectivity via screen scraping. And there were some very old interfaces in Germany and called the home banking standard. It was called FinTS or
Yeah, FinTS,
HBTI.
yeah.
Yeah. But it was rather used by software run on Windows PC. So no web versions were used back then. And roughly 3 years ago, or 4 years ago now, we decided it doesn't really make sense to build full front-end solutions. Our PFM solution was a front-end solution, and it doesn't make sense to integrate front-end solutions into existing banking front-ends. It never really looked good, and it really didn't make sense at that time. So what we basically did, we did quite a big shift. We got rid of our front-end, and we kept all the back-end technology. The back-end technology was basically the aggregation part, the connectivity to all the banks. And our second biggest asset was the knowledge about the banking data, because we had to categorize back then the data for the personal finance management solution. And we reused this again. So now we know a lot about the banking data. We can identify salary payments or loans, etc. And this was all based back on the technology of a personal finance management solution. But we built an API layer on top, and now with this solution, with the API approach, we can reach a much broader customer base. So it was a very good shift. It was all pre-PSD2, and we were actually quite lucky that the PSD2 came into place because it basically pushed our existing business model.
Yeah, I didn't know that. It's a surprise for me as well, because we are in 2020 and people are still talking about the PFM solutions. But 12 years ago, you just started this journey. I think it's a wow, and I'm also surprised with the story of FinAPI. And you mentioned a little in your answer about PSD2, and we are really close to a new regulation in Turkey as well, really close to the PSD2 and the open banking side. Can you please share your experience and all your journey with PSD? I think it started with PSD and then it's now PSD2, and people also are talking about PSD3 as well. And can you please share the history of PSD issue in Europe and how it all began? What was the journey? How banks integrate or comply with this regulation? How do you see the PSD from your point of view?
Well, I can mostly talk about PSD2 because that's the most relevant and recent part. Also about PSD3. PSD2 was a big change in our model, especially for the German market, because it kind of gave a regulatory framework to the already existing business models. We were aggregating data before, we were delivering data to third-party applications, but there was no real regulatory framework, and it had kind of this image that it's not quite safe, it's not really allowed. What are you accessing the banking data for, etc. And with PSD2, this was actually it came to the broader market, and now it can be used on a very broad scale. However, the PSD2, it had a big downturn or downside implemented. It was just a side effect, but it had a huge impact. It was the two-factor authentication introduced with the PSD2. Before PSD2, you could just sign in into your bank account with a username and password, and this username and password could be stored in an application, and the application could download the data for you. And it was quite convenient, and a lot of people got used to this. And now with PSD2, it makes a bit more complicated because you have to enter your second factor, the 10, for example, every 90 days, which makes it harder for the finance management solutions, for example, because they no longer can run fully in the background. You need the end user interaction on the screen. But on the other side, it prevents companies from just pulling data without the end user or the bank user knowing about it. So I think it's okay, but this is what the market is currently adjusting to. So we can go a bit in depth on this, but what we're currently talking about is PSD3, or it's a two different streams. Like a lot of banks here in Germany, they started a discussion if they could or should provide, they call it premium APIs. So we got the regulatory part, the PSD2 APIs. That's a free part. Banks have to provide this data for free. But for them, it is not really a nice spot to be in right now because they have to invest in all the infrastructure to provide data via APIs, but they cannot make any money on it. So now they are discussing premium APIs. And the discussion is also, should banks be forced to provide additional data? That's the PSD3 discussion. Or can the market agree on additional banking data delivered by the banks voluntarily with the paid data? We personally, we have no problem paying this data as long as the quality and the stability is really good, and this would actually help the market. But this is the discussion that's currently going on, and the biggest issue on this discussion is, from my perspective, that all the banks need to agree on a set of premium APIs because it doesn't really make sense for example, for an e-commerce shop, if they get data only for, let's say, 20% of their end users, then they will never implement such functionality. So it's the big question, and I don't have an answer yet if the banks will all come together to agree on a premium API framework, or if we in the end have a PSD3 that will force the banks to go this way.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I think they are changing the term open banking to open finance. So I think, we believe that the banks should provide much more data to their customers. But yes, the standardization of this data is really crucial because it's not easy to integrate all different banks and collect all these different data sets and creating value on it. It's not easy. I think PSD brings this standardization and usability to the market. Yes, I agree with you. And also in the Turkey market, it is somehow different. The banks have a lot of APIs on the ground. As Isbank, we are part of the Isbank group. We have more than 30 different APIs on our API market, but the regulation came after. So now it's for Turkish banks, it's now it's a scary movie because we will have a new standardization. So they have to make a refactoring on their API side. So we are really excited about this new developments in Turkey. And it's great to hear your voice from Germany, from Europe. It's a quite great for our near steps.
Yeah, well, the one more aspect to PSD2 here is that the PSD2 only covers checking accounts, and it does not cover saving accounts. And for example, it does not cover portfolio accounts. However, we were used to aggregate these accounts or credit card accounts, for example. And we were used to aggregate these data as well. And we're still doing this, but at the moment we're using three different interfaces. We're using the PSD2 interfaces for checking accounts. We're using the old HBCI FinTS interfaces for portfolio accounts. And we use a lot of screen scraping, for example, for credit card accounts. And this is, I don't think this makes sense that much, though it would make a lot of sense from the bank side or the regulator to include these account types, especially credit cards, for example, in their regulatory framework, because it doesn't really make sense for an end user or a bank customer to see only his checking account data while he's paying a lot with a credit card or, let's say, PayPal. So it needs to broaden the view on the regulatory side there as well.
Yeah, I think you're totally right. We have a solution in Turkey called TechCep, which means one pocket. We are focused on the commercial side, but we are facing the same problem that you mentioned, because it's not enough to see only one type of account in your solution. You have to integrate all your financial data to give a decision with this data. And I think, yes, we have to enlarge this regulatory framework to other data sets as well. And with this new type of scenarios, can you please give us some insights about the use cases of this open API network or ecosystem in your territory, so we can share this with our fintechs coming and the banks maybe in Turkey?
Yeah, so it's actually one of the most interesting parts in my job is to see all these different companies that started to work with banking data. Well, the quite obvious one, and that's been around all the time, is the PFM, the personal finance solution, or the multi-banking apps that you see. So this is pretty basic. But what I thought is quite more interesting in the past is that we're seeing some more focused use cases. For example, we have one company as a customer. They are targeting landlords, just private households that are renting out apartments, or one or two apartments. And they included our interface to check automatically with the PSD2 if the rent was paid on time by the tenants. And if they are not paying on time, you get an automatic process, you get an email reminder, hey, rent did not arrive or not the right amount. And do you want to send an automatic email to remind the tenant for paying his rent? So this is just one use case, but it gives you an idea. We have a lot of use cases where we automate the bookkeeping, where you automatically check whether invoices are paid correctly, and you can send out the warnings afterwards automatically. So these are the common use cases. But there's also some e-commerce use cases where they integrate the PSD2 interfaces for payments, for example, or some use case we introduced lately, which has nothing to do with the core of PSD2, but we call it GiroIdent, which is kind of an identification solution based on bank account access. You can think of You want to identify that the person that's currently shopping in your shop is really the account holder and has access to the bank account he's paying from. Then we make a login via the PSD2 into the bank account. For the successful login, you need the username, password, and the TAN, so you're quite sure that this is the account holder. And then we receive the account holder name from the bank account and transfer it back to the e-commerce shop, so he knows if the one ordering a delivery at the moment is the same to the account holder. You're pretty sure that this is not a fraudulent ordering. So this is just some side use cases. They are on top of PSD2, but not really intended by PSD2, but it shows you the power that will come from such regulation.
Yeah, you just opened my mind. Yes, with this data of account data, yes, we can create a huge set of use cases. Thank you. And for Turkey, you are way behind the days you started the PSD2 journey, and now we are really close to the new regulation in Turkey. Do you have any suggestions for the banks, for the regulators, and for the fintechs when you see all your 12 years journey? What would be your suggestions for us?
Well, the biggest suggestion is that you should start talking to each other. This is what all the banks here in Germany said after they finished implementing the APIs. Then the fintechs started testing these APIs. And then we said, hey, this is not really working. This doesn't really make sense how you implemented it. And then they say, well, we should have known earlier because we already spent millions of euros for it. So in the end, you should create a round table or something like this where you at least have the leading fintechs talk to the banks and say, what do we need from the APIs? What are the use cases? For example, we had a huge debate here whether it's necessary to deliver the account holder name or not. At the end, the BaFin had to rule, yes, you have to deliver the account holder name, but half of the banks have never implemented this, so they had to spend huge amounts and quickly introduce the account holder name. And instead of having talked to each other beforehand and defining this set, this was all done after the implementation was finished. So talk a lot to each other, and also talk about the benefits for both sides. So it shouldn't be just the cost burden for the banks. The banks should also see the upside in providing this data because this is now starting nowadays. But I would suggest that you include what I call the premium API discussion and the basic API discussion in one go. Yeah, one more point. It's pretty much all banks are also consumers of these APIs because they aggregate the banking data from other banks or they provide solutions for loan applications, etc. But the discussion in Germany was pretty much focused on with the banking guys that are in charge of providing the regulatory part. So for them, it was only a cost side, but they never had the beneficial part, like the business side on the table. So this would also make sense. It also be a suggestion to have both sides from a bank on the table because they will play basically the most role, and the biggest consumers of the APIs in Germany are the banks themselves.
Yeah. Thank you, Florian. Thanks for all fruitful insights for your long, long journey. And thanks for coming to our interview series and being with us. And hope to see you in Munich soon after this pandemic situations. And thank you again.
It was my pleasure. And we'll closely look into the developments on the Turkish market. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.